Are you going to swear?
Fuck.
You're listening to the Beat Motel podcast, and we need to warn you that we like to use words like fuck, shit, and syndicalist, butty scruttox, angry flap, and filth biscuits. And we don't often bleep those words out, apart from because we're not complete animals. But if you understand that and you like music, then listen on. Hey, welcome back to Beat Motel. I have a special guest who has been here before. I'm here with Dan Callis. How are you feeling, Dan? You full of energy and ready on this sunny afternoon?
I just woke up from a nap.
Nice. Okay. Yeah. Are you a regular napper?
Yeah, I love it. Self-employed. I've been going for a lot more of it recently. I don't know why. I think it's just like in the day I'm bored because no one's about. Everyone else is at work. So I'm like, well, I've got nothing to do, so I'm going to go have a nap.
When I was a teenager, a lot of my friends were the year below me. So when I was in that sort of end of days sort of GCSE era where you get study leave, they're all still at school. It sucked. There was no internet.
Yeah. So I'd be suspended from school. Like, it'd be like, what do I do? Oh, no, I'll go up to school at lunchtime and just go hang out and get told off. They called the police on me once.
Did they really? I managed
to chase through the nature reserve behind King Edward School in Bury by the police. And while I was running away, I broke my. You remember those crappy canvas belts you used to get?
Mm.
Yeah, mine broke. And I was
How did your belt break while you were running?
Because they were crap quality and I was wearing baggy jeans because I was a little teenage Grebo 20
just
years
the
ago.
Just the sheer weight of the material, the belt was like, fuck this. So you were running from the police with your trousers falling down once your belt had broken.
Yeah, the school had called on me because I went to school and I was suspended, you know. Crime of the fucking century.
What on earth would you have been, like, charged for by the police for that?
Trespassing or something lame.
Ah, so you know. Was this, point of order, was this a pre or post Criminal Justice Act?
When was the Criminal Justice Act?
Oh, God, I don't know. It was the 90s, actually, so it probably
was. After the 90s.
Ah, see, a trespass wasn't a criminal offence until after them.
Yeah, well, I don't give a shit what a criminal offence is. I'll do what I want.
Let's start doing what you want by playing your riff of the week, and then we'll explain the theme. Here we go. What was that?
It was Tory Scum Get to Fuck by a Scottish Gabber punk.
Was that the theme to Blue Peter playing in the background of that?
Possibly. They do use a lot of weird samples. They did a version of Barbie Girl, a cover of Aqua's Barbie Girl that's really worth listening to.
That Gabber sound is so troubling. It literally sounds like your speakers are ripping apart.
So good. I love it. That's like, I mean, that beat with the chorus, Tory Scum, get to fuck you, Tory Scum, is gold. Because you don't need to really say a lot more than that.
No, it's very efficient. I love the cover as well. Well, at least the thumbnail on the YouTube video I ripped it from. Because it's like it's the cover of Rumours by Fleetwood Mac.
He's
got his foot on, like, was it cans of Tennent's or Iron Brew or something.
Yeah, everything they do is a brilliant parody. And that's what I like. I like music that doesn't take itself too seriously, but also, like, actually is, like, really, really good and clever.
That's what attracted me to the world of punk in the first place. When I say the world of punk, I mean, you know, like early 2000s or late 90s kind of Fat Wreck type bands, because they could be kind of have a nod and a bit of humour, bands like No Use for a Name, but still write really good songs and be brilliant bands.
Yeah, exactly. And I think, I don't know. Like, I don't think it is a joke though. Like, it's humorous, but also has a point. I mean, they've got another song, that record you play, the intro song, is like a chant of a football crowd. I assume it was a football crowd chanting, "You can shove your coronation up your ass," which I think, although it's like a very Scottish sentiment, you know, as someone who's anti-monarchist, I can get on board with that.
Well, they've captured something. They're capturing something for history. Although stuff like that's never going to age, is it? It's like a lot of the Thatcher stuff from like early 80s punk, nothing's changed. It's only the name.
And I think, like, you know, hard times create greater art.
So we should be fucking killing it now.
Yeah, we should all be like making a real point, but instead we're all just sitting in our room pressing buttons on electrical equipment. Sending it to our friends and then putting it on tape and selling it to our friends.
Well, it keeps us out of trouble mostly. Right, this is my riff of the week. What do you think of that?
Dirty.
That's Iron Monkey. The song's called Rat Flag. And
I thought it was Iron Monkey. I've got an Iron Monkey record downstairs, actually, which I picked up in Out of Time because I just saw it.
Oh, wow.
And I was like, oh, do you know what? Like, I'm going to grab that because they're not a band that I'm like hugely into, but I do like a bit of, like, you know, because I'm such a collective taste of stuff. Like, I find like sludgy sort of stoner stuff like that. I was going to guess it was either Iron Monkey or I Hate God.
Mm. Yeah, I've not heard I Hate God, but I've heard the two band names kind of mentioned in the same breath like that. I think that's new. That's new Iron Monkey. They've got a new singer because the singer died a long time ago.
Is that new? They've got new stuff out.
That is a new song. And it's I really like it. And I like how, with a lot of sludge stuff, it doesn't really go anywhere. it's like the band spends a lot of the time perfecting the sound rather than the song. Whereas the whole of that song, Rat Flag, it actually turns corners and arrives at places and leaves you wanting more. It's absolutely great.
Nice. I'll have to check that out, the new Iron Monkey, then, because I do like a bit of a riffy sludge.
I think the other appeal for me with that is, I think if bands decide they're going to down tune and they're going to do something heavy, they're sort of almost two divergent paths. You can either just go straight up metal, which I also love, or you can sort of come at it from this real more sort of grindcore, sort of anarcho, dirty squat punk angle. Yeah. Iron Monkey are definitely the dirty squat punk angle there.
Yeah, I know, like, a lot of those bands in that scene just really like heroin.
That is one of the weird things that I don't understand, because I first heard Iron Monkey when Sam, who I normally do the podcast with, he bought like a box set. And then, yeah, there's pictures of needles and stuff in it. And it's like, well, I'm so from the other side of the punk scene where anything like that would be in there because it's so anti. Mm. So there's some smack issues, is there?
I don't know. I think America has a very different drug culture to the UK. You know, I think in this country, it's hard to be a functioning addict to that level. Like in America, they just seem to be like, you know, like I've got friends and obviously family out there. And it just seems like they just like the things that we would be like, oh, you know, like having a spliff and going to work's a bit annoying. They're like, yeah, I'll go to work on six lines of meth. Like it's fun. But I think, like, you know, people talk about Heroin Chic as like this iconic fashion brand, and I just think, like, Heroin Chic to me is I Hate God.
I had honestly never put those two things together at all. I don't know. Some stuff, like obviously, like stoner rock, you know, that's kind of clearly kind of weed and stuff. And although my band, we played with Orange Goblin, and they were like, oh, we don't understand why people think we're in a weed. You know, it's coke or nothing for us. And I was like, because you play these big, sludgy kind of stoner riffs.
They say stoner rock is a gateway to harder drugs. So, you know, like that's, like, you know, Orange Goblin are like, yeah, we started out as a stoner band, but now we're just coke heads. And I don't know, I Hate God, I just like, we really like heroin. I remember once one of my friends who's really into them, when they announced the tour, he just said, I really need to go see them because I don't know when one of them's going to die.
God, no, that's oh shit. I've seen what they look like.
Shouldn't laugh, but so I imagine like, yeah, I really like this band, but like they could just drop dead at any moment because they're just so on drugs.
It's the heroin sheet thing I find so weird. Like Leftover Crack sort of had an element of that, didn't they? And I can remember I might
just didn't wash. Same thing, innit?
What the same thing as having a smack habit, just not washing.
It's all same aesthetic, innit? You end up sort of.
I suppose so, yeah.
I'm not being horrible to like people who are heroin addicts here, by the way. Like, I'm well aware that heroin addiction is horrible, and you know, I've had addiction issues myself, not with heroin. So we are very sympathetic to anyone who might be listening to this who might have issues with addiction.
Well,
and
yeah,
we should go to the appropriate helplines that are available or start fucking awesome sludge band.
Yeah, I was gonna say thanks for pointing that out, listeners. Dan and I have known each other for a long time. We're both kind of very much from the same sort of part of the music scene, or not music scene even, just sort of bunch of friends. And we'll talk about drugs in a way that sounds either disrespectful or very lax or lapsadaisical, but yeah, that's not really the case. So yeah, we're not, you know, if you got your struggles, man, you got your struggles, and
yeah,
keep one.
And the war on drugs has failed as miserably, and I am firmly in favour of decriminalisation and treating addiction issues if we could. And funnily enough, that is a take this morning I saw agreed with by Gary Lineker. So I think the tides are changing.
Oh, they beat Motel back when it was a paper scene. One of the stickers that we printed hundreds of and gave away is "Drug Laws Cost Lives."
Got that on my bike.
You've got it. I think you got it on your coffee table as well, haven't you?
That was my old coffee table. That has since left me in a breakup because it wasn't my original coffee table. But yeah, it was on the coffee table. And you had that one that says my other guitar is fucked and spelt guitar on it wrong.
I gave away so many of those before somebody pointed it out. I think it was somebody said something like, yeah, it's really clever because it works on two levels, because you're saying your other guitar's fucked, but also the sticker's fucked because you've misspelt guitar. And I was literally like, what?
Yeah.
Yeah, I should have just said yes. Right. Theme. We have a theme for this episode. Dan, do you want to share it?
Yeah, it's I Like Their Older Stuff, I believe, is what you called the episode, which is a much more creative name than bands that released a really good record and then never lived up to the hype. I think my selections are a mix of, because some of the bands you would argue, well, actually their later stuff was more popular and made more money. But for me, it's like, or like, it might just be like, for some of them are like the band that I've picked had a lot of hype around them, and I think they did match that hype, but the collective of the world or the scene didn't really agree. So, and I've really kind of, a lot of these selections I've really gone back to my youth on. I think they're very like post-hardcore-y, screamo-y, emo-y selections.
You put a lot more thought into it than I did. I was just trying to think of bands that I liked the first album and didn't like stuff after that. So
yeah,
we'll play your first one and then we'll dive right into it. So
let's do this, baby.
I preferred their early stuff. Look towards the sky before you die. It's the last time you will. I like sort of the logic of those lyrics. So who was that, Dan?
Don't know. I never heard of them. That's Metallica, obviously. If you don't know that, it's something wrong with you, really, I think. Like that is, if like anyone who knows Metallica should know For Whom the Bell Tolls, because it is their best song.
Ah, okay. So what is it? Why is that so good? And why is their modern output so dire? I'm not a fan of any of it, so.
Are you not a fan of Metallica at all?
No, there was an episode we did of this a few months ago, and it's called Convince Me to Like Metallica. And it was Sam choosing.
Oh, I need to listen to that.
Sam choosing a bunch of Metallica songs to try and convince me to like Metallica. I must say, I warmed to them a bit, but
did I think he play it will that? Come to.
I can't remember, but what it comes down to for me is, when did, how old were you when you got into Metallica?
God, I would have been about 13 or 14. And I think when I first heard them, I was, because obviously, like, I was like 13 and I kind of got into like music. I'll say music, I was always into like chart music. But what made me discover is, oh, I like angry music with guitars in it, was bands like Limp Bizkit, Korn, Papa Roach, because I was 13 in 2000.
That's a very specific time.
Very, very specific time. And seeing that will come back is an interesting topic for another day. But when I heard Metallica, I was kind of like, it's not quite hitting like that angst that I was feeling at the time, you know, as cliche and lame as 13-year-old angst is. Yeah, I did have my own problems, but, you know, articulating them as a 13-year-old was impossible. And someone just going like, fuck you, I won't do what you tell me, just kind of nailed it. And I think Metallica really liked that. And then when I was about 14, I heard One came on like the telly and I was like, oh, this is like an absolute rager. And that was kind of what made me get into Metallica. But I remember at school, like, people would always be like, you know, because obviously you'd see like the stuff on telly they were doing at the time, like, you know, it's just before Sen Anger, which we will talk about. We will talk about Sen Anger. And I felt like, you know, at the time it was like that Mission Impossible soundtrack, I'd Disappear, with, and like, you know, like, their newer stuff was like Load and Reload, which weren't quite heavy, and everyone was like, oh, you know, it's old Metallica. And I just found, like, you know, when I went into their old back catalogue, I like going to the shop and buying the CDs or borrowing them with friends, I was like, you know, Ride the Lightning, Master of Puppets, and Justice for All, you know, Kill 'Em All isn't a record I had much experience with till later, because I never actually got that one, and this was before you could just go on the internet and listen to music. And I found that, I just found that like thrashy long song structure to be like, this is what Metallica should be. And I think they just like the bigger and more successful they got, you know, like if you hate Metallica, right, the best thing to watch is Some Kind of Monster, the Sen Anger documentary about the production of that. Because see how much, like, other than Kirk's like, I just want to chill out, ride my horse, go surfing and play solos, man. Like, I ain't into all that drama. But Lars and James Hetfield were just absolute bellends throughout. Like, you know, like, and I know James Hetfield had like alcohol addiction issues while they were doing it, but he was just so like, oh, my, like, you know, they've got all these like people advising them, like life coaches. He's like, my life coach says I can't work after four. And it's like, if I was in a band with someone like that, I'd just be like, dude, like, this isn't a job. You're meant to enjoy what you're doing, you know, like, and you're trying. And then Lars was getting pissed off at that, but then Lars is a bell end as well and was too busy going like, oh, you know, I'm like this deep, like, he was like almost like trying to act up for the camera, and rather than just being like, oh, let's put some cameras in a room and see how Metallica are in real life, it was like really trying to like present himself as like this like cultured art like bro who like goes to art exhibitions, but actually he just looked like a dickhead. He was waving around cash. But yeah, like Metallica, I think, are one of those bands that, other than Death Magnetic, which was a brief return to form for me, they've never captured what they once had. And I find them really boring live. And I think Lars is a shit drummer, but their early stuff, like if they had of like, you know, Black Album and stopped, I think they would have been like, you know how like At The Driving got to Relationship of Command and then like created peaked. This legacy because it was such a peak record. But I think because the Black
Heroin
Album
with them
was
as well, wasn't it?
What?
It was Heroin that fucked them up as well.
Yeah, I think it was. And I think, you know, they liked all drugs. They used to go away on tour and just leave their house doors open and see what squat they'd come back to when they got home. Like, fair enough. But yeah, I think with Metallica, it's like this idea of like, because they shat on their legacy so much, I think the Black Album is almost like the start of the downturn for me when I look at their back catalogue. And that's funny because obviously the Black Album has Enter Sandman on it. It's their most successful breakthrough album, when they sort of said, let's stop writing 7-minute songs and write 3-minute ones instead, and like really got their production game up. But also, like, the older stuff for me just does it.
I'm the older stuff I do like a lot more. I did watch the Some Kind of Monster thing, and it didn't help. It didn't endear me. This is years ago. It didn't endear me to Metallica. Much the same thing. I just thought, well, Kurt seems nice. Yeah. Bob Rock just seems to be struggling to actually, I don't know, keep things under control. And I was excited to see Scott Reeder in it when they're the bit where they're trying out the bassist, and the bassist to Caius, and Goat Snake is in it. Mm. But then he's talking about Lars being a bell end. He basically, the guy they want to hire as the bassist, he takes him out and gets him horribly drunk the night before. So when he's actually auditioning, the poor guy can barely stand up straight. And I just thought, I don't know, it seems like a dick move to me. But my theory on Metallica, which I've conjured up just this second, is that if you get into Metallica before you're 16, you're probably going to love them for life. Not all the output, but they're going to have like a real special place in your heart. Mm. If you're not into them by the time you're 16, they might not connect.
Yeah, do you know what? Funnily enough, talking about the last episode I did earlier, you know, like they were really close to being on my list of bands I wish I hated, but I don't.
Mm.
As well, like they do kind of float both of that for me, but I do think like their early stuff is like, especially like Cliff Burton before he passed away, you know, sort of up until Master of Puppets, I think some of those songs just have such a place in like iconic metal moments, and you like, you cannot deny the importance they've had to, like, you know, not just creating the thrash sound but mainstreaming heavier music. Because, you know, it isn't that heavy, you know, like, but it is to sort of, if you're not like us, oh, my fucking connection just went. Can you hear me?
Well, yeah, that was an internet fuck up. Anyway, could happily talk about Metallica at length, but that would make two episodes on Metallica for someone who's not really that much into Metallica. So, Dan, I am going to leap forward and play my first choice.
Yeah, do it. I should recognise that, and I don't.
Oh, see, I was going to say if you do, because you really surprised me with Iron Monkey. I didn't realise that they, you know, in fact, you then said you just picked up a record in our local record shop. That is Crime in Stereo.
Crime in Stereo, a band I never listen to a lot, and I really should. I always get them confused with Death by Stereo.
Well, no, that's entirely reasonable.
Yeah,
that song is everything changes, nothing is ever truly lost. So that was kind of like early 2000s.
Was that one of their early records?
That was from their first record. I think it's their first one, but they were on Bridge Nine or one of those sort of very trendy hardcore
labels.
Bridge Nine,
yeah, I remember them.
But that was the first sort of, that was my first sort of, I got sent it when I was doing Beat Motel as a paper zine, and that's the first time I listened to something sort of ballpark hardcore, and that opening, I just went, yes, I need
this. Yeah, the way it drops out is pretty cool.
But I love them. I went to go see them not that long after I got sent that. Sort of literally, oh, the shit, they're playing in the UK. So I went there and I met them. They were playing in one of those shitty little basement venues, like somewhere like Camden, that's got space for about 25 people in it. And then by the time I last saw them, they were supporting Newfound Glory, and I saw them at the UEA.
Oh wow. What's you prefer their earlier stuff about them then? Did you say they peaked too early, or
that first album's classic first album syndrome? It's got years worth of ideas and everything's crammed into the songs, and it's very efficient. There's no sort of flabbiness.
Mm.
But the second album, they had a bit more time in the studio and they clearly gave it a bit more thought, and they start to say really wanky things in interviews, including interviews with me interviewing them. And one of them was, the singer said, well, the first album felt like I was making an album as a band. And the second album felt like I was making an album as a musician. And I sort of get that, but I think to actually say that stuff in interviews is just kind of odd. And then the third album, somebody reviewed it, might have been in Maximum Rock and Roll, and it said, this is the sound of a band disappearing up its own arse.
Oh, wow.
So the first album's brilliant. It's kind of hardcore. It's one of my, you know, easy, you know, like Desert Island Disc type albums. Second one's got some good stuff. The third one, I can sort of see what they're going for. And then by then, no one cared, even though they were touring, doing these massive tours.
Yeah. And I think like that is something that's quite symptomatic of what we're talking about is, you start that band, it's fun. You've got all these cool ideas. And sometimes, especially in punk, I've had bands where I've been in, you just hit a point where you're like, we've run out of juice. Like, the ideas aren't flowing. Like, you know, it's become a job, or, you know, like the fun has been sucked out of it. And now you've got pressure, you know, especially when labels are involved, to, you've got to have a record out by this date and it's got to be done by now. And, you know, you're trying to write those songs between touring and, I always say, like, big, you know, there's a lot of parallels between punk and wrestling. You know, like, when you're a wrestler, you've got to stay in shape, travel all the time, you know, and also go out and perform every night. And there's, you know, how do you find the time to develop?
Be creative. Because I always thought that's the weird thing. When I first started doing kind of short tours, I thought, wow, there's tons of sitting around not doing anything. Mm. And that is true. But for some reason, it's not very productive time. Because you can't do anything, can you?
No, it's boring. Like, I always describe tour as waiting around for something else to happen. If you're not waiting, you're waiting to get to the venue in the van, and then you're waiting to load into the venue, and then you're waiting to sound check, and then you're waiting to go get some food, and then you're waiting to play, and then you're waiting to load out, and then you're waiting to go to where you're going to stay, and then you get some sleep, and then you wake up and you're waiting again all day. Like, it's...
You get some sleep if you're lucky, because, like, staying in mates' houses, they're like, hey, party night, and you're like, yeah, but it's been party night every night for the last,
yeah, I'm dead, I've had enough. And you always get those people as well that are like, oh man, that must have been a really fun experience. You're like, no.
The first time I started gigging like that, I was determined to keep a tour diary. Oh god, that'd be a good tour diaries would be a good subject for Beat Motel. And I think I wrote about 2 days entries and just didn't have it in me after that. I was just like, no, even I don't care.
I used to get really, like, one of my bands did a little bit of touring. I had to leave because I was just like, I was gutted because all I ever wanted to do was play music. And then I finally got into a band that was like, wow, we could actually, like, go do this more. And I found just being away and trapped and surrounded by people in a van. Also, at the time, I was drinking quite heavy and it just made me a really anxious mess. And I was just really homesick the whole time. And I think now I don't drink, I find that now I don't drink and I'm financially stable. I don't, you know, like, all those little stresses that cause anxiety would probably be a lot more subsided. But in, like, my sort of early mid-20s, it was a real sort of blow for me.
I think the reality is now, because, you know, it was early 2000 since I've done that, really. But now I'd take my MacBook and I'd work. Could just to have my brain do something and do something else, I'd probably work sitting in the van or whatever, which sounds really sad actually, but to me that sounds like quite a good coping mechanism, especially to keep that grip on reality.
Yeah, exactly. And I think as well, there's a lot of people that, like, in freelance, you know, like, I've read a lot of articles about, well, what do these bands that are, like, you know, semi-successful, particularly UK ones, do for a job? Because people are genuinely surprised to learn, like, you know, I remember the article had a Posh, who's a member of Palm Reader, who have recently announced they're splitting up. But, you know, like, they were, like, sort of, you know, a semi, you know, you call them, like, almost like a professional UK act. Like, you know, if they existed 30 years ago, they probably would have been making a living out of it. And it's like, no, I work at Nando's. But there was someone else on an article I read who was in a band who was a graphic designer. And he's just like, yeah, I'm just off on tour and I do my work. I know, I think it's Patrick from Self Defense Family. When they played in Portsmouth, he got up early in the morning at my mate's house because he had to go and ghostwrite for some social media accounts that he runs.
I don't want to talk about what you and I both do for work, but that sounds completely kind of, yeah, that sounds par for the course. Let's have another track from you.
Let's do it. Let's
Who is that?
That's the Bled, and the song's called You Know Who Seatbelt.
That video is one of the most early 2000s, early I've ever seen. The clothes, the way they're making the video, they're doing this thing where the band's playing and the camera's like lifting up and over, like yeah. It never stops.
It's a cool video. I think the video like still looks really cool and it's got good energy to it. The Bled are an interesting one for me because, funnily enough, what you just said about crime hysteria, I think that might, I'd never thought about that aspect before of like bands going through that. And I think there might have been an element of that with the Bled of, you know, I think when they wrote that album, it was all very much wrote by like a couple of members. And I think when they got bigger, I think it was like, right, let's have more collective creative control. And I don't think their albums afterwards never quite hit that real like, oh, that's the spot. Because, you know, Pass the Flask is, you know, anyone who's a The Bled fan, you know, you ask what's the best The Bled album, they will say Pass the Flask. And that's not to say that, you know, the ones afterwards weren't good, but I don't think they ever quite captured that real sound of just like there was a lot more production value. There was a lot more going on. And I think what made The Bled The Bled was the fact that they could just go dun, 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 and just make it sound like a fucking war.
Well, you would just, you don't have to overcomplicate that. You know, use, I think it was Jesus Mary Chain, said, you only need one note. Just play that one note really fucking well, which I think absolute truth. But something that makes me wonder about bands like this, where they start off raw and angry and cool, and they're putting all their best ideas in because they really give a shit. I'm not saying they don't give a shit for albums after that, but either the fire's not there or they purposefully want to change. So like Black Flag, I told you about that book I read, Our Band Could Be Your Life. Turns out it's really old and loads of people I know have read it. With that, the guitarist was very consciously saying, I do not want to be classed as a hardcore band. I want to become something else. The same with, you know, other bands around that era. So I wonder if sometimes they do that, but they do it too quick. Because when bands could have 10 album careers, you know, 10 albums over 15 years, and that'd be what you'd get, you'd not be in any rush to develop. You'd be like, okay, you know, we quite naturally and organically change. You know, well, it happened to the Replacements.
Gabber for a prime example of that, you know, like you can hear the evolution in their sound as they go. You can hear that like nice little like layer of like sort of influence being pulled in. And I think with the Bled, I think a lot of it was a victim to the hype machine. I think they were right place, right time in sort of this growing MySpace scene and, you know, really peaked. But, you know, like that album, oddly, I remember reading an article about it when it came out and it didn't sell that many copies, but like everyone knew it. And it's just what's so weird about it. Like, I remember the first time I heard it was in my mate's car on the way to college. I was about 16, 17. And it blew my mind. And, you know, they have got some good later stuff. Like I love all of the Bled's albums, but they are definitely one of those bands where you're like, when you say, oh, I'm going to go off and listen to the Bled, you'll usually jump straight into Pass the Flask.
I've just looked it up. It's 2003. It's 21 years old. But that it is so of a time.
They're doing a reunion show, actually, and playing that album in full.
They're probably still younger than we are by several years. In that video, they literally look like children.
I think maybe you. I think they're probably the same age as me. I think they're somewhere in between me and you.
Oh, cool.
When I first saw them live, I was 17, and I assume they would have been like early 20s.
This is something else that I think's really changed in the last few years. Bands, by the time they get somewhere, they're now almost too old to have a long career.
Yeah.
Or if you get bands who get really big when they are super, super young, they've probably just been fucked by the label. They're sort of like, there's no perfect way to do it other than DIY or die.
And I'm also incredibly jealous of any young artist that finds their sound and their voice in such a strong way at such a young age. Because, you know, I'm in my mid-30s and I think I'm now at a point where, you know, but you never know, you know, like I wouldn't have known 3 years ago that I would have been producing electronic music that I feel like is like my best artistic work, you know. For me personally, I don't give a fuck what anyone else thinks.
See, that's crucial. I think that is how that happens. You know, I make music now and I just sort of punt it out there. I can't be fucked with it on a streaming service. I'm probably going to take everything off anyway. But yeah, I couldn't give a shit.
Back catalogue KLF style.
Yeah, but no one would care if I did it.
Yeah, exactly.
It'd been a great disturbance in the force. What could possibly have happened? Oh, yeah, Andrew Culture's deleted his stuff off streaming. No! Yeah, it's not going to happen.
Yeah, like with all three of my monthly Spotify listeners.
Yeah. No, I've got... This has got to be a blip, right? But I got something like 400,000 streams on Spotify. And there's no data to back it up. Again, not going to talk about what we do for work, but for work, we see stuff and we get the data and we figure out how it happened. It's a blip. And it made me like £14.
I was about to say, I was like, and how much of that 6p did they let you keep?
I don't think, actually, it might have been more. I don't think it was as much as £14. But right, let's go on. Let's have another choice. I might not play the whole of this one, and I'll tell you why. To be honest, that's enough. It's not going to change. We can only play 30 seconds, but it sounds like that for 30 seconds. Gone.
What was that?
Oh, if you had said, oh, of course, that is... It's a band called Spaceman Three.
Never heard of them.
Right, I've chosen this for a really odd reason. I didn't want to just choose bands like that I still really, really love, but I wanted to choose a band that interests me and I feel like I should like them, but I'm not much of a big fan. You know, all the pieces fit, everything works. So Spaceman Three, that is from a live recording, which is an album. It's one song, one track. And it's called An Evening of Contemporary Sitar Music. And the story of it is they put records out, but they hired their local leisure centre, essentially, or like art centre or something there. But they couldn't afford the venue, so they did it in the foyer. And they billed it as An Evening of Contemporary Sitar Music. And it's two guitarists, a drummer and a bassist. But I read the book that the bassist
wrote. There's no sitar.
There's no sitar, and it's not Indian music. You'll sort of get possibly a bit more what they sound, where they're from. But the bassist, I read the book that he wrote, and it's really good. It's just one of those, if you're in a band or you're a musician or you just like music, it's just a good book to read. And he said he was so fucked when they recorded that. He was nodding along. He said, I thought I played the best ever, but you know, it took us a while to get going. So we all got really, really stoned. And it was only at the end of it that he noticed that he hadn't actually plugged his bass in. So there's no there's no bass on that. But he also said the other thing I learned, or they were tripping as well. He said the other thing I learned during that is if you're looking at your hand playing bass and you've got too many hands, stick with the one on the far left.
Oh wow, that's good to know.
But that band kind of imploded shortly after that, and one half of them went off and formed Spiritualized. You remember them?
No, I don't know them.
They were like a late 90s, early 2000s, like huge indie band when that was still a thing. And the other half went off and did other stuff and now makes loads of music for films. But they were like pre noisy indie stuff. There's and I like noisy indie
stuff.
Sounds
quite pretentious as well from what you said, so I'm on board with that.
Yeah, and strangely, they are also smackheads. It seems to be an awful lot of it about in this episode. But
should we do a special of like our favourite heroin music?
See, the whole concept of heroin music, I was reading something in another book, and it said you can tell when you listen to a band what sort of drugs they're into. And I was like, yeah, well, stoner rock, psychedelic acid. And then it said, especially heroin. I was like, who? What type of bands are
Alice
heroin
in Chains,
bands?
Nirvana.
But does that define them, or is it just a coincidence that they also
no,
had
I
issues?
I think Nirvana sounded like Nirvana before Kurt found heroin.
Mm.
And
that's what I mean.
And he founded heroin as in, like, yeah, like he created this drug.
Yes, well, inventor of heroin. Right. But no, I just chucked that in there because... Their early stuff was like that. They had the classic thing where the labels hassling them for a hit, so they go and record a 40-minute long drone and just fun stuff like that. But yeah, all the parts fit, but I just don't get it. I don't really understand it. So let's go for your next choice. You know how you said Crime in Stereo? I should know them and I should have listened to them. Who was that, Dan?
That was Alexisonfire, No Transitory.
I know that name. I've seen it written so many times. I've read about them. I've never actually listened to them. And there's some parts in that little, even that little clip, that I fucking love. I really, really love.
The Tomorrow Harmony is, I still remember the first time I heard that. I'd bought the album at, was it MVC that used to?
We had to be a member to buy stuff.
Yeah. I bought the CD at MVC when I was at college, and we listened to it on the way back in. My mate Kyle's old dark navy blue Ford Fiesta driving between Bury and Beck Row. And that same song came on, it blew my mind. And that album in itself, like, is like my last summer before I like went off to university and like moved away. Like, it's such a sort of pinnacle part of my life. And Alexisonfire, I remember the first time I heard the first album, which is self-titled before the one you just played, like, at the time I'd never heard anything like it. It was so like, and now in comparison, you know, like, being, bear in mind, I was like this kid who's like a little bit of a punk and hip-hop, like, you know, Epitaph and sort of those labels, to hear something that just sounded so scatty and shouty and almost like hard to listen to, and it seems funny now, because now that is really tame compared
Absolutely. I mean, I know what you mean, though. I would have found that impenetrable when I was that age, but I didn't get into sort of heavier guitar music until, well, I don't know, my 20s, I guess. But what I really liked about that, one of my bands that I nearly chose for the previous episode of Bands You Like But Wish You Didn't was Taking Back Sunday.
I love Taking Back Sunday, and I have no shame in it. I don't wish I hated them at all.
No, not at all. I didn't choose them because
they're great.
I don't know. I haven't heard enough of them. Like, Decade Under the Influence, I saw a live clip of that someone showed me years ago and just went, this is fucking brilliant.
And it's well hit or miss live as well, depending on Adam Lazari's voice.
I love the fact the singer was just absolutely all over the place, but then the other guitarist, his voice is so powerful.
Yeah.
And so absolutely perfectly controlled. But it's a lot of the things I liked about Taking Back Sunday. I like about this, I thought it was Alex Is On Fire.
So a lot of people did when it first came. I still hear people confuse it. I have the same problem with DS Happy Boy and people thinking it's D Shappy Boy, which I quite like. I've done a bit of an Alexis On Fire there.
Smart.
But it's accidental. But I used to annoy me, now I just find it funny. I'm just like, cool, whatever. But yeah, that album for me is, I think afterwards, because they really, after the album, the song off the album you just played, they released Crisis, which was like their big kind of like penetrative album that everyone knows and everyone calls their greatest. But I think for me, because I discovered them like just as Watch Out came out and they were really new and stuff, like by the time Crisis came along, they were already on like this massive hype train. And I think in my own head, that album, like no album has ever lived up to the hype of those first two albums in my own head. And I like bits off, you know, the two albums that came afterwards. Even the one they've just done the year before, Otherness, which was, it doesn't sound anything like that. It's listenable, but I'm like, if that had been the first album I heard by them, I wouldn't have fell in love with that band.
That's the crucial thing. And you've made me realize that that's perhaps some of the issue I have with bands like Metallica. The first album, my first experience of them wouldn't have been the stuff that the fans really dig, you know. And one of the things that amazes me about listening to stuff like Alexisonfire is, contextually, anyone like, you know, my daughter or anyone who's younger now listening to it hears it as a part of a far larger scene. Mm. At the time, that music came from fucking outer space. Yeah, it was so original and so new, and it was a real head turner. I'm amazed that it never became mainstream. Or did it just sort of move along and become?
It depends what you call mainstream, really. Like, no, it never really, like, I don't know. In America's such a different place as well, but I think, you know, like, they could sell out like a 2,000, 3,000 capacity venue, you know. And I know, like, how do you define mainstream in this day and age? Like, you know,
screwed, probably.
Are you comparing mainstream to, like, well, we started out playing in like scout huts and basements, and now we're here? Or do you define it as, you know, there are bands where, you know, their quiet era was when they were playing, you know, 400, 500 capacity venues, and then they went on to doing like fucking stadiums. But, you know, whenever I saw Alexisonfire live, it was always in a massive venue and it was always sold out.
Wow. Thank you. I'm going to look them up more because I really enjoyed that. There's so much. I always think of it as like it's thoughtful music, as in a lot of thoughts being put into the writing of the songs. Mm. Whereas previous to that, a lot of sort of guitar bands got too thoughtful on the production. So you got this, especially late 19, early 2000s, you got this production which would be absolutely flawless and absolutely soulless. But they'd forget you got to write a good song, or that there'd be too much emphasis on what the words and the singing were, and the instrumentation just became something that was backing for it. So when stuff like that came along, it's like, yes, people are writing proper songs with proper instruments.
I think one of the core things for me, I think you saying that has really reminded me about writing songs, is on those first two Alex albums, it doesn't feel like there's a single song on those records to me that are filler.
Mm.
And everything that came after, I felt like, you know, for me, it was like, well, I like this song, I like this song, I like this song, but I've never listened to the album in full. Whereas, you know, like the first, I recommend, like, you know, when you've got a spare hour and a half, put the first Alexis album on, then the second Alexis album on, because they're both incredible.
Probably will after this recording, but exactly the same thing with Crime in Stereo. First album, no filler. It is
the
tight.
Intro will blow your fucking mind. 44 Caliber Love Letter on the first Alexis album. Like, bearing in mind, like, you listen to it and remember that, like, I'd never heard anything like it when it first came out. Like, I'm sure there's people who are like, well, there's bands that sounded like that who did similar things. You know, like, I discovered Mr. Bungle and realized where System of a Down got a lot of their influences from, for example.
I've never thought of that.
But I think like those records for me as like a 16-year-old kid, like my brain exploded a little bit and it was fucking brilliant.
Oh, I love the fact I'm nearly 50 and I can still get the same thing now. I'm genuinely like quite excited to listen to that.
Yeah.
But we ought to play another song, so I'm going to play this one. Ooh, do you know who that is?
No, you cut the vocals, so I didn't have a chance to, but...
that was the 30-second mark. Fu-Manchu.
Fu-Manchu, I've heard the name, never listened to.
The thing that amazes me about that is... Oh, they're on Grandmaster. Grandmaster Recordings? No, sorry, I've got distracted by the Wikipedia page there. So could you date that? Could you tell when that would have been recorded?
You want me to date it based on how it sounds?
Yeah.
Okay, let me have a guess. See, I'm going to say late 90s, early noughties.
Fucking hell, you're good. 1997.
I was hearing a lot of like Queens of the Stone Age kind of... like there was a slight grungy element, but it had kind of got a little bit more punkier and rockier. So I thought this is kind of like the social acceptance of grunge.
Well, you yeah, you're great. You're much better at this than I
am. I'm not. You just played me a band that I don't listen to, so clearly I'm not that good. I know fuck all, because there's too much music and not enough time to fucking listen to it all. And 99% of it is shit.
I'm going to tell you why I chose this. First of all, the good stuff. So they were start of, you know, stoner rock properly becoming a thing, but they're not slow. And all their imagery at the time is around skating. So the cover, the album's called The Action Is Go. That song's called Evil Eye. And the cover, I'm pretty sure it's, I've forgotten his name. Really famous late 70s skater. You see loads of pictures of him skating bowls on like, you know, a tiny little skinny board with massive wheels. What's that? Tony Alva. That's it.
Tony Alva. No, I don't know his name. My skateboarding knowledge of that era is, my skateboarding knowledge is all noughties. I don't know who's doing what anymore.
Oh, no.
Tony Hawk games for me.
He was, Tony Alva was, you know, mid 70s sort of thing. But yeah, that they came from the same sort of stable as Nirvana and the Melvins and bands like that.
You can hear it.
Mm. But the reason I chose this one is that's an early album and it's great. There's so much good on that album. But then they didn't change and they're still releasing albums now.
I feel like that about the Melvins, you know, oddly enough.
Now, the Melvins willfully will do the most unlistenable, horrible shit just to be awkward bastards.
That's buzz all over, isn't it?
Yeah, I saw them. I saw them supporting Slayer, would you believe?
Amazing.
It was Melvins and then Sleep.
I know Sleep. I've never seen Sleep, so I'm very jealous of that.
All right. Well, they played the whole of
Dope Smoker.
Yeah. Of course. Or Jerusalem, whichever you want to call it.
Did you smoke some dope before it?
I don't like being. I've never liked that being in packed environments. It was at Alexandra Palace. It's because Slayer were playing Rain in Blood from start to finish.
Oh, wow.
Which they fucked up and had to restart about three of the songs. But Melvins, right, first on, well, they went first because there was loads of bands playing on throughout the day. But they were third from last, I guess. So Melvins, Sleep, Slayer. So bear in mind, that's a very particular audience, Slayer. It's the only gig I've ever been to where people walk around the radio go, Slayer, Slayer. And Melvins came on, and instead of doing their sludgy big riffs, they did these songs which were off an album they had at the time. And they're like sort of American marching school band call and response things. You know, like the Marines. Hey,
there's a band called Big Business that kind of like had a very Melvin sound like that. And I think that was like the cool thing that they were all doing was like big snare rolls and tom rolls and. There's that Big Business song that has that ridiculous intro where I can't remember what it's called. I think it's called Another 4th of July Ruined, where the intro is like just the kick drum and then this ridiculous snare solo over the top. Like,
so the reason I'm either going to look like a CUN thingy now, or you're just going to go, yeah, I know. So you're saying the Big Business had that Melvins type sound.
Yeah.
Well, the Melvins is at that time was Buzzo. It was a Cody Willis drummer and a bassist called Jared Warren.
Yeah.
Big Business is Jared Warren and Cody Willis. They basically
I didn't know that. I've only because my mate played me that Big Business record like years ago, and I never, you know, I'm one of those people where a lot of music, unless I get really, really, really into anything, I'll just listen to it and go, cool. That's on my radar.
Cool, nicely done. Yeah.
Cool. No. You'll pop up every now and then. But yeah, unless I'm really into something, I don't really read. But I assume you're a much bigger Melvins fan than I am.
I've seen them a bunch of times. And I always meant to listen to more Big Business stuff because that sort of appealed to me more. But yeah, basically Melvins, Big Business. And bizarrely, Big Business used to support the Melvins on tour. So like,
yeah, I know they're similar. I think they're on the same label and everything.
It's literally the same people. The only difference between the two sets would be that Buzzo would come on for the
band with Buzz, I'd probably start a band without Buzz as well. Imagine it was a fucking nightmare to work with.
Oh, man. Right. So that we went nicely off track there. So let's get back on track with your last choice. I apologize because that's probably the worst bit of the song I could have clipped.
Yeah, you clipped the outro. I thought you'd go for a chorus because the chorus of that song is massive, but we'll live with what you've done.
Who was that? I'll explain why that happened, but who was that?
That's Portugal the Man.
Never, ever heard of them. Never heard of them.
I was very late to the party, actually. So Portugal the Man, about 3 years ago, I let Spotify go off and do one of its shuffle things, and I was like... Because I'd heard the name before and I'd heard some of their stuff and, like, you know, this album came out, I think, like mid-noughties. So, you know, I'd picked up the name before and I'd always sort of just thought it was kind of like a bit kind of like, I don't really know what genre we call it. They're kind of like a genre floaty rock band. It's kind of experimental. But that album, when it came on, I went and put it on. I'm like, this sounds like so At The Drive-In influence.
Oh, man.
And then I was like, all right, well, let me try. And then I sort of like put them on shuffle and just went, well, let's listen to some of their later stuff. And it's funny because obviously I found this band with this big back catalogue of like, you know, getting on for 20 years. And as I got deeper into it and more recent, I was like, this sucks. Sorry, Portugal the Man. But for my music taste,
listening at home going, bollocks.
We really needed to impress that short, opinionated, cynical prick in Ipswich. for me, that album, like, I ended up getting it. My then partner got it for me on vinyl for my birthday, so I have got it on vinyl. And it's a great record, and it's just really clever. It's got that real kind of like, it's almost like a poppier At The Drive-In.
I'd go for that.
Yeah, and I think that record is amazing. But, you know, after that, there's only two or three songs that I've really found. If anyone listening to this is really into Portugal the Man and can point me to like any other of their records, because I got to a point where I couldn't be bothered to listen to anymore because I was like, this is just getting shite. So if there's any people out there that are really into them and are like, nah, listen to this album, please do recommend it to me. But other than that, I'm like, yeah, just that album. I don't have anything more to say about that, really.
I love the outro. I like there's like a squeaky bed or something in the background. And this is what I was referring to earlier about, I always like bands who make a bit more effort.
Mm.
Just try and just drip a little bit of sugar on something. Go, okay, this is really cool. But let's just do a little something to make it cool. But the reason I chose that bit is because I don't know any of the songs that you gave me to clip. I said to ChatGPT, in this song, what's the fan's favorite bit? Not expecting to get anything back. And how did it do? Because that's where the bits that I clipped, the timestamps, all came from GPT today.
It's done all right, actually, funnily enough. I would say the only one it fucked up is the last one.
Yeah, shit the bed on Portugal the Man. But the rest of them thought it was okay. Now, the Bled and Alexisonfire, I thought they chose really, really well, because yeah, it is the middle eight or the drop just before it all comes back in, which is the real payoff for that kind of band.
Well, if you heard that clip, I recommend you, the song's called Killed Me the King, but I'd recommend, I think the album's called something, hang on, let me look this up on my phone.
Well, I'm
the album's got a really stupid, pretentious name.
I've got I was going to say a long list of songs to play. No, there's
Waiter.
Three bands.
It's called Waiter, You Vultures, but with the most awkward typography you can imagine, with like quotation marks, but the song's called Kill Me the King. But I recommend putting that whole album on, really, because it all just sounds so good. If you're into At The Drive-In, that album is a nice pleasant surprise that really caught me off guard a few years ago.
Looking forward to that. Actually, At The Drive-In were another band that sound like they came from outer space at the time.
Yeah, well, I mean, I love At The Drive-In, and I love their, you know, that's why I'm talking about this record now, because, you know, I was like, holy shit, this sounds like At The Drive-In.
So did you...
I liked At The Drive-In's most recent album, and I know people went, it's not as good. And it was never going to be Relationship of Command, but I think if they had released that follow-up 2 years after Relationship of Command, people would have been like, cool.
I've not heard it yet, but a Relationship of Command, just, it's a perfect album, start to finish. There's no, every song's in the right place. The speed ups and slow that are all perfect.
Production is amazing, album. Like, you, even if you listen to their older stuff, you could just, it's the same with Nirvana and Nevermind. You can just see that's what a producer does.
Mm. Yeah, absolutely. Right, my last choice then.
Let's do it.
You know that?
I recognize the voices and my mind is blanking.
Oh, the voices. Yeah, that I'm gonna have to tell you how I came upon this album. I heard first time, I think I was probably 15 or 16, so when it came out, and I had one of those friends who would just bring stuff to the friendship group, and this is fuck, it's the early 90s. So spending time with friends, if you grew up rurally, would be going to each other's house, sitting in a room, probably drinking beer, and just putting CDs on and listening to music.
I did it in the early noughties, mate.
But it seems such a pure kind of thing, such a simpler times.
I do it with records still sometimes. When people come over, I'm like, I'll just go through my record collection. Like, you can't see because it's a podcast, but there's a video. But I just flick through my fingers and say stop. And then whatever I stop on is what I play.
That's awesome.
The story of how I bought that record and why I have that record.
That's awesome.
I like that record. It's cool. It's cool again. Like, it's cool to do at people's houses. Like, I recommend it.
No, that's smart. We play something called the chain. So no one's allowed to veto anything, but we tend to start off with, like, we'll always start off with like some power metal or just something really daft, and then take it in terms to choose a YouTube video that's got some connection to the previous one, however tenuous it is. That's quite fun.
I thought the chain was some kind of game involving smoking lots of cannabis.
That's never happened. So this came out to me. I'd always loved hip hop, but sort of never really knew how to latch onto it as a teenager.
You haven't actually told me who it is yet.
I know, but I'm going to tell you who's in it. So it's Prince Paul.
Don't know Prince Paul.
He was the producer for De La Soul.
Ah, right, De La Soul, yeah. Mm-hmm.
RZA.
RZA was in Wu-Tang, wasn't he?
Yeah, he kind of was.
I think that was a voice I picked up on. I picked up on a bit of, was RZA in Wu-Tang? I'm going to feel really bad if I'm wrong here.
RZA was Wu-Tang. Watch the American Saga thing. It's on Disney.
I haven't watched that yet.
Fucking good. It's brilliant, absolutely brilliant.
Yeah, I never got around to watching it because I kept wanting to put it on, and my partner at the time just wasn't into that at all.
No, I had to watch
now,
it.
Now I'm single. I'm gonna watch that.
Stick with it, I'd say, because the first three seasons, first season is mostly they go well into the background of the people, which is good. But
I want
not...
it. I love Wu-Tang. I'll take it all in, mate.
So. I heard this album, became obsessed with it front to back, absolutely loved it. It's 1994. And then it wasn't until probably about 5 or 6 years ago I realized there was any connection between this and Wu-Tang. So
that's what I thought it was. I thought it was like some early Wu-Tang or a Wu-Tang song that I hadn't picked up on. But
what happened was Prince Paul made friends with RZA. Because RZA had a single out as Prince Rakim. You love you.
Oh, I know. Yeah, I know that song.
Basically, another guy in it. It's Fruquan or it's Fruquan, who's in Stetsasonic, who are another kind of pretty cool late 80s, early 90s hip hop. And basically, Prince Paul said, "Look, he had his own studio. I'm going to put together an album, and we want it to be like gothic horror hip hop." And RZA, he was like, "RZA, you know, I think you're great. Do you want to be on the album?" He's like, "Yeah." So they recorded the album. Nobody wanted it. Like, no record label wanted to put it out. But when Wu-Tang hit, suddenly, obviously, the labels were like, anything we can get hold of, we want to put out. So it came out then. It was out on G Street, which in the UK, at least at first, was Virgin 2, V2, the record label. Mm. But yeah, sorry, I still haven't told you the name of the band.
No, you haven't, you bastard.
Gravediggers.
Gravediggers, cool.
Fucking brilliant.
Was there a natural progression between kind of the Wu-Tang, we want to create like a horror, kind of like, you know, almost like Misfits, but hip-hop, I guess, is kind of what you're saying.
That's what Gravediggers kind of was, yeah.
Because then Wu-Tang is obviously very influenced by like old martial arts and kung fu films.
Mm.
Like, you know, like the Shaolin Shadow puppet boxing, whatever reference that are all on like, you know, Enter the Wu. 36 Chambers and stuff, you know, they sample a lot of like, you know, like fight scenes from old kung fu movies and stuff.
I think I really enjoy doing this, having this sort of recording with you, Dan, because you make me think, see things in a different light. Because when
I
you
have
watch
ADHD,
when you watch American Saga, you'll see that RZA, he's basically trying anything he can to try and get traction. And it does make me wonder if he went off to do Gravediggers and Prince Paul and Fuquan were saying, "Here's a thing, here's a theme we have," whether he then went, "Ah, that's the way you do it," and went back and brought all the kung fu stuff into Wu-Tang. Yeah. very perceptive of you.
I just remember, like, you know, for me, Wu-Tang, when I got into Wu-Tang, it was Gravel Pit came out in, like, 2000 when I would have been, like, 12 or 13. Which is still
it's a banger.
Yeah, and like, I went out and bought the W, and I genuinely was a bit disappointed because the rest of the records wasn't like that. And I was, like, a 13-year-old kid who just wanted to hear Gravel Pit over and over. And like, I did, because, like, the thing about Wu-Tang stuff is it's all so underproduced.
Well, this is... I think, yeah.
Well, I appreciate that now, but I couldn't appreciate that when I was 13.
This is one of the things I like about Gravediggers, is that having got into so much more hip hop, it's easily like at least a third of the music I listen to is hip hop now.
Well, I need to go listen to Gravediggers after this, definitely.
So this album, I literally am not going to say the name of the thing on the recording, but I'll message it to you.
Has it got a naughty word in it that you can't say?
It's got, there's not a lot, many words I won't say, but this is a word I won't say, and please don't say it.
I'm going to guess what the word is, and I'm not going to say it based on my knowledge of hip-hop culture. but yeah, okay, you got to go listen to Alexisonfire then, and I'm going to go.
Oh, no, I absolutely will. Yeah. But yeah, so going back to this, it's so raw and so... just, it's not loose, it's dirty, which I really, really like. Whereas their later stuff, they did a second album that was all right, and then it was largely over by then. Have you seen the word? Don't say it.
I haven't looked.
Oh, sorry, I pasted it to you on Telegram.
Oh, right, I haven't. Let me check my phone. Hang on.
Let's see if I can get you.
What are you saying? Oh, Jesus, yeah. Fucking hell.
Yeah, that,
I thought it was just going to be like some kind of like, I didn't think it was going to be like, not only like, obviously it's not a slur for them saying it, it would be a slur if we said it, but not only, but it's also like a parody of.
I know. What a word, eh?
It's
probably on the streaming, I don't know if you can stream, but if it's on streaming services, it's under the name 6 Feet Deep, because it was renamed. I bought this on vinyl from... you know, Marcus, who's involved with Brighton the Corners and all that stuff.
Yes.
He has a record shop, which is a pop-up record shop at St. Stephen's Church. And I walked in and I saw this album on vinyl, and literally walked in and went, like, must possess. And I was paying him for it. And I said, oh, yeah, it's not the original title, because the original title was... And he went, his jaw dropped. I was like, I'm not going to say the word. And he went, no, okay. But I could see for a split second, he probably thought I was going to, it was all these families around. No! Of course, the original title was, I'm not even going to say it and bleep it out. It's not.
We appreciate the music, but we don't say the words.
I mean, no. It's a cisgender white male British person, is not my place to even have an opinion. To be honest, I'm just not going to say it.
It's not your art either, so get fucked.
Well, exactly. I'd realize I was shitting myself into a corner there, which is like painting yourself into a corner.
I like the fact that you think so lowly of me that you had to tell me not to say it.
No. I don't.
Like, Callis is, if anyone's going to do it, it's Callis.
No, it wasn't that. But I thought if I sent it to you and you just automatically went, oh, it's just, I don't think you'd do it to be edgy or to be like, oh God, bloody Callis. Of course you would. I thought you just might accidentally just out of like mild shock, accidentally say it out loud. But yeah,
my edgy humor aims to inspire, not offend.
Inspire and educate, not offend.
Yeah. It's took me a long time to learn that. Yeah, you know, I think I've got
that. That is a good conclusion, but yep, go listen to Gravediggers. That first album is so spot on. So very, very cool.
Awesome.
We're going to have to wrap it up because I've got to edit this bastard thing now because it all fell apart in the middle.
Yeah, you'll figure that out.
Thanks for your support.
That's right. Well, you gave me your editing software and said, I'll do this video. And I was like, you'll figure it out. So now it's your turn.
Smart
approach to everything. You'll figure out.
Nah, you'll get there.
Thanks for having me again, though.
Oh, thanks for coming along. I thoroughly enjoyed this, and I've no doubt get you back at some point in the future again. So I'm going to say goodbye, Dan. Do you want to say goodbye?
Bye. Love you.